Good morning. Today is Tuesday, October 23rd, 2018. My name is Anne S. Peskin, and it is my honor and privilege to interview Susan Nabel for the Jewish Historical Society of Fairfield County. Good morning. Tell us your name.
My name is Susan Nabel.
And where and when were you born?
I was born, I'll do the where first, because that's less painful. I was born in Miami, Florida, February 25th, 1948.
And how old does that make you now?
That now makes me just over 70 years old.
Who are your grandparents?
My maternal grandparents were Charles and Edith Bear, who lived in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. And my paternal grandparents were Tilly and Frederick Neuberger, who lived in Bay Ridge, Brooklyn, and Jamaica Estates, Queens.
Okay. How they earn their living?
I'm sorry?
How did they earn their living?
My mother's parents were basically, actually at one point, farmers, who then moved into the town of Lancaster and worked in various retail establishments. My father's father was a plumber, and his wife worked at home.
Tell me a little bit about your parents.
My parents were both travel agents in the early days of actually air travel.
And where were they living at the time?
Both of them lived in Manhattan when they met. And then they both were, actually shortly after they got married, they were both transferred to Miami because they worked for a cruise ship line. And I believe that I lived in Miami with them until I was about a year and a half old. And then we moved to Levittown, New York, where everyone was moving in 1950. Mm-hmm. And my father continued to work as a travel agent, mostly for airlines. He worked for a firm called Westheim Travel. And my mother stayed home to raise me and my sister, who is 5 years younger than I am.
And when did you move to Fairfield County?
I moved to Fairfield County with my husband in January of 1985. We had been living in Brooklyn until then. Before Brooklyn, we lived in Manhattan. And we actually loved where we were living in Brooklyn, but I loved it more than my husband. My husband grew up in Connecticut and needed to be in a commuting distance of New York City, but had had enough of New York. So we moved to pastoral North Stamford, Connecticut.
And talking about your family, were they involved in any way in politics or community service?
I have to be truthful and say my parents were not. They were involved in community organizations, but it was actually community theater, but not really community service. My grandmother, my father's mother, was a member and proudly had served as the president of the Jamaica Estates Women's Club in Queens. So I think that she was involved in community service, but nobody ever really in politics.
And what was it like at dinner? What kind of conversations did you have?
It's kind of difficult to actually remember. My clearest memories are when I was older, when I was in high school. When before, during, and then after John Kennedy was elected president, that elicited a lot of conversation, mostly in the beginning about religion, about the fact that he was the first Catholic running for president, and what did that mean, and what could it mean. And I was a bit of a renegade because I thought he was wonderful, like practically every other teenager. And my parents were much more cautious about that.
Where'd you go to college?
I went to Barnard.
And when was that?
I graduated in 1970. So I was there through the, I don't know if you would remember, the SDS riots in 1968. And my graduation actually coincided with the Kent State incident. So I was there at a very tumultuous time.
So how did that education influence your political views?
It influenced my political views at the time quite a lot. And I would say that it was the first time in my life I really felt a divide between people who were politically active and idealistic, and between people who had political ideas but also had to work for a living. I referred to the SDS incident because I worked my way through, like everyone else, I worked my way through college. I had a night job at Lord & Taylor on Fifth Avenue. Barnard was on 116th Street and Broadway, and I lived up there. But every night I went to work in the accounting department at Lord & Taylor, where I have to put this in there because it's, no one would believe it anymore. We still sat for 6 or 7 hours at night with adding machines, with the day's receipts, adding up the receipts. So I'd come home again at night, and one night I came home and got off the subway at Broadway and 116th Street, and there were police and smoke and barricades and people all over the streets, and I kind of beat a path around that and went to my apartment and went home, went to class the next morning, and the professor of that particular class was talking about what happened last night and how this was a big change, and I finally had to raise my hand and ask what had happened. And I was immediately ostracized by everyone else in the class because I wasn't A, aware, and B, hadn't been a part of what had gone on. And I felt struck by the fact that if you have to work, you can't always be in the right place at the right time politically. And that is, that's still something that, that strikes me every week. And I probably will come back to that at some point, so I'll stop.
Who are your political heroes? Before we do that, you used ST. What did it stand for? Because this goes back. You talk about the ST.
SDS?
SDS.
It was Students for a Democratic Society. And that was a group that took over the dean's office at Columbia and pushed for Columbia to get out of Harlem as a landlord because they were buying more and more property. Pushed for fewer restrictions on the dorms. In retrospect, they weren't so radical, but they thought they were radical. And they did. The SDS did grow and I think became connected with Jerry Rubin and the yuppies and that whole thing.
Coming back to, who were your political heroes growing up?
Well, my first one I referred to was John F. Kennedy, and probably my first political act was to write a letter to the editor of the Bergen Evening Record after Kennedy was elected, because the dinner table conversation at that time was, and I can't remember the specifics of what he was doing, but both my mother and my stepfather at the time were irate at some of the reforms that he was doing. My stepfather was a Korean veteran and was also actually very much in support of the Vietnam War. So we had some pretty heated discussions about that, but they didn't like him, and River Edge, New Jersey, which is where I lived at the time, was a very Republican community. So to be a Kennedy supporter was very radical. So I wrote a letter after he was elected saying, we just elected him president, we should support him.
And what defines politics for you?
Well, I always go back to all politics is local. I think, and it's one of the things I like about, and I find exciting about being on the Board of Reps, is that I guess what defines politics is how people with different goals and different needs get in the same room and work things out so that at least most of them are moving forward to the benefit of the largest part of the group. So that's what defines it for me.
When and why did you decide to go into politics?
You know, I guess I had to admit that I was going into politics, but the first time the first time I wanted to run for the Board of Education, a seat had opened up on the Board of Representatives, and the way that I'm a registered Democrat, the way the Democratic Party operated at that time was you needed to be interviewed by the leader of the Democratic Party, and that person, who's Ellen Kamhi, would suggest where she thought you would be the most useful. And it turned out at the time someone was leaving the Board of Reps, they needed someone to fill the seat. And her suggestion to me was, so go and do this, and then we'll talk about the Board of Ed. So I think that was when I found myself going into politics. I had been an active parent PTO president and parent leader at Roxbury and Clunan, where my children were in school, and I did not grow up in an environment where anyone would even refer to school as public school. I mean, school was school, and I guess it's public. But when we moved to Stanford and my kids got in the school system, I started to hear a lot of distinctions made and drawn between the public school system and private schools. And so my Democratic side kind of got its back up, and that's really the spark that made me become more and more active, and then that turned out to be politics.
I know what party you belong to. Why?
Well, I think because in the years that really formed me with Kennedy and the Vietnam War and all the other radical movements that were going on, I did feel a separation from the really radical left wing of people who supported democracy and freedom for all and civil rights and all that. I never felt that drawn to that side, but the basic message of all people are equal, all people should have equal opportunity, and the government should provide something of a support system and a social safety net for people, I think made me a Democrat before I knew I was a Democrat. And then again, the Republicans in that period when I was really paying attention were not people I wanted to be associated with. So, I mean, there was Nixon and Goldwater. Goldwater actually was the first Republican I was conscious of, and he was part of those early dinner table conversations as well, as a Republican, not as anything else.
Now we'll talk about what you've done. What offices did you hold?
I was on the Board of Education from 2000 to 2009. During that time, I was president three times. And I'm sorry, but I would have to look up which years those were. I think it might have been
So you ran three times?
I ran three times for Board of Education.
Right.
Yep.
And when did you serve on the Board of Reps?
My chronology is actually when I had my first conversation with Ellen Kamhi, and she suggested I fill a seat on the Board of Reps. That was 98 to 2000, so those 2 years. And then 2000 to 2009 on the Board of Reps. And then I took some years off and I ran again in 2013 for Board of Reps.
Board of Reps is what, 2 years?
No, it used to be 2 years, it's four now.
Wonderful. That's better.
Now I'm in my second term on the Board of Reps.
Can you tell us a story about one or more of your mentors?
A story about one or more of my mentors.
I guess it's Ellen.
Well, Ellen would be the biggest one. That first conversation about was I ready to run for the Board of Education, which, as you know, was very dear to Ellen's heart and probably her most passionate area of interest. She and I ended up having several disagreements over educational philosophy, but in the beginning, when I first met her, we thought along the same lines. We both recognized the fact that the strength of Stanford schools comes from its ability to balance so many conflicting groups, and I use the word conflicting on purpose, groups and interests and ethnicities. And she, as you know, was active in creating the magnet schools. And as my children progressed through the system, I really began to value those schools and the difficulty of meeting the needs of so many different kinds of student populations. So, but one of my favorite stories about Ellen is I was eventually elected to the Board of Education. I served 3 years, and then in my second term, I was elected president the first year, and she came to the first meeting, which I ran, and it was the first time I had run a meeting, and it was a little nerve-wracking. And she came up to me at the end, and she said, "I'm very proud of you, but next time, don't talk to your shoes, look up and raise your voice." So that was one of my favorite Ellen Kamhi stories.
Is there another mentor you were thinking of?
There have been not as clearly a political mentor as Ellen. Polly Rao was also someone I grew up with my children as their principal. Actually, we lived on the same street for a while. I very much respected her ability to be in charge of pretty much whatever group she was with, whether it was the school or a classroom or the PTO or whatever. She I always felt she was a leader with a very clear vision and a very defined path to wherever it was she wanted to go.
You weren't on the board at Board of Ed with her, were you?
No, she actually just followed me.
Could you talk about one of your philosophical disagreements with Ellen?
So the last 3 years that I served, 2006 to 2009, The year before that, my board had chosen a new superintendent for the schools. And we went through the process in 2004-2005. We selected a young man named Joshua Starr, who at first Ellen was very much behind, very much in favor of, I remember Ellen saying on the day that he was introduced to the public and everything, Ellen said to me, kind of off to the side, but she said, finally, we have a Jewish superintendent. But as his tenure continued, he, and this wasn't a surprise to me, but it was a surprise to Ellen, he was very much in favor of equalizing, academically equalizing the school system, that is, doing away with tracking, not with grouping, but with tracking. With when kids get to middle school, they were organized into honors and kind of college prep, and then everybody else, which our, that superintendent was actually hired to one of his goals, which was attractive to the school board, was to detract the school system.
He came from New York City.
He came from New York City. Ellen was not in favor of that at all. And he lost favor with her, I would say, after a couple of years. He had some other, there were some other conflicts and clashes in his tenure, but he was pretty much hired by the school board that I was on to be a change agent, and I would say that he very much accomplished that. So that would be one of, that would be, probably be my main argument with Ellen.
What were some of the obstacles you faced, and how did you overcome them?
Obstacles in running for office or?
Running for office.
Okay. Well, actually, it would be running and holding office. And it does go back to what I said earlier about working for a living.
Oh, yeah.
During the time I was on the Board of Reps initially, and then as I continued on in the school board, I began to notice, you know, people who are elected often refer to the night shift as coming on because the meetings are mostly at night, and the people who actually run the city are, I mean, they stay if they have to stay for meetings, but they're mostly gone at night. And what I noticed, though, was that the people who were the most politically connected and generally in the most powerful positions were not people who punched a clock or even had a job like I do, where I don't punch a clock, but I'm kind of expected to be present during the day and am generally at someone else's beck and call.
What do you do?
I'm an office manager for a recruiting company, it's a very fine job. I enjoy it. It's all people oriented, but it's not the kind of job where I can say I'll be in at 11 a.m. or I'm taking tomorrow off and it's not a vacation day. What I noticed after a while is that the attorneys, some types of consulting, they were the people who seemed to be able to be available if the superintendent needed to meet with them at any time of the day, or if the mayor called and said, you know what, I want to have a conversation about something. And that kind of availability creates a hierarchy among politicians. I have never been able to really, I always do my best to say, I need to go to this meeting, I'll use my lunch hour, or I'll stay a little later, or I'll come in, or whatever. So the biggest obstacle to me has really been working for a living. It has, I would say, prevented me from really jumping in with both feet to be available and to give as much time as I possibly could. Now, I don't like to say this right after that because it's not really secondary, it's more parallel, but also raising children. My kids laugh at me still because in the early days when I would need to go to a PTO meeting and my husband was home at night, of course I wouldn't leave them by themselves, but I would say, I just have to run to the grocery store, and I'd be gone for 2 hours because I didn't want to always be saying, I'm going to a meeting, but usually I was.
Let's go back to campaigning.
I enjoy campaigning. I don't enjoy making phone calls, but I really like going door to door. I really like standing out in front of a supermarket and not necessarily foisting myself on people, but shaking their hands and hearing what they have to say. I have always found people to be very polite, and if they do want to stop and talk to you, they really want to stop and talk to you. And I like listening to that. I like the diversity, wide array of just meeting different personality types and hearing different interests. In the campaigning that I do on the Board of Reps, as we were saying before, it's within my own neighborhood, within my own district, so that literally is door to door. And that's kind of like visiting your neighbors.
How much, I know you had to raise money.
Yeah.
How much did you raise?
For when I ran for Board of Ed, I did not raise as much as other people. I'm not, I would do the things you're supposed to do. You're supposed to send out a letter, you're supposed to have a couple of parties and coffees, and I would do those things, but I'm not very good at asking people to write me a check. I would say that when I ran for Board of Ed, I raised around between $5,000 and $7,000 each time, but there were others who were way over that. I pretty much just raised what I needed for signs, for a giveaway, and maybe for a couple of ads. For Board of Reps, it's much less. The last time I ran, I didn't form a committee or raise any money. I bought the signs and did it by myself. Because another thing, I don't know when is the right time to say this, but two things. When you ask me about politics, I still don't really think of myself as a politician. I think of it as public service. I really have no aspiration to ever be anything above a very local level. And part of that comes from what you just asked me about, how much money did you raise. I guess I have the luxury of being kind of horrified at how when you decide to run for office, the first thing you have to do is form a committee to raise money with a treasurer and a bank account. That's the absolute first thing you have to do. And from where I have sat over the last few years, it appears to me that the higher up you go, the greater that pressure is. And it's only common sense that the more people who give you money, the greater the sums they are, the more you're kind of beholden to the people who are giving you money. So I don't want to get into that. And local is not completely pristine, but it's easier to manage.
Were you involved in debates?
On the Board of Ed, yes. We did have candidate debates at the Board of Ed.
How did you feel about them?
The years that I ran, there were anywhere from 5 to 9 candidates, and so you would have 9 people going down a table answering the same question. It got to be pretty easy, unless you were the first person to get asked the question. It was difficult not to repeat what at least one or two other people in the table had said. I like them. I don't have a particularly good head for numbers, and I can't sit and immediately, like Dan Malloy, can just spout off whatever statistics, percentages, dollar amounts he needed to remember. I'm not that good, so I usually have to have a little number cheat sheet. And I also have a tendency, which you might have noticed already, to sort of self-edit as I'm talking. I'm not as articulate as I would like to be, but I do my best.
What are some of the main issues that you had during first your tenure at the Board of Ed, and then perhaps at the Board of Reps?
A main issue with the Board of Ed was always, and I think still is, the size of the school population, how it's growing, the types of students who are helping the population grow, and matched against the existing facilities. So the city has always, since 1990, when my kids entered school, there's always been a problem with aging facilities, classrooms that are too crowded, the lack of upkeep in most of the buildings, and how to pay for new buildings to accommodate the growing population. When I was on the school board, we were very fortunate in two ways. One, Dan Lulloy was mayor, and he believed in education, and I think also saw it as a real linchpin in helping Stamford grow as a city. He was generous and aggressive and ambitious about helping the schools grow. That gave us a real momentum and a campaign that we could carry forward. The other main issue in Stamford is what I referred to earlier in education, and that is how to meet the needs of children who come to kindergarten or come to 10th grade with no formal schooling or very little formal schooling, who have varying degrees of preparation, who can read a little bit or not at all, who've never seen a printed book, going to school in the same classroom as children who spent 2 years in preschool, can identify all their letters and colors, and how to push everyone forward. I don't follow the schools on a day-to-day basis anymore, but I know that those conversations are still going on, and that's still a challenge, and it always will be in Stamford until we have more facilities resources, but more teachers, so that's been a quest all the way through.
You weren't involved with any of the unions, were you?
I believe I sat in on negotiating 3 teacher contracts, but you know, there's a filter in between the school board and the unions, and that's usually an attorney who's a very good labor relations attorney. And the school board sits in one room and says we want X, Y, and Z, and the union sits over here and says the same thing, and he comes together with their attorney, and you know, they find a middle ground, they go back. But it was a fascinating process, and I am 2 steps further removed from any negotiations with city unions on the Board of Reps, but I have said this to my husband, that if I could come back and do this all over again, I would go to law school and learn labor law, because it's the driver of so many of our problems.
What about the Board of Reps?
What am I answering?
Main issues?
Oh, taxes. And how does the city spend its money? I do think that our tax rates in Stamford are not as egregious as many people think they are. Mm-hmm. If you compare us with Westchester and some of Massachusetts and definitely New Jersey, our property taxes are not that high. They are high if you compare us to Greenwich or Weston or the other places people think we should be like, but those places are not cities, and we are a city. One of the things that I think the Board of Reps and the Board of Ed have in common is that no one wants to say we're a city. The schools all want to say we're a suburban school system, and the people on the Board of Reps who represent anybody but downtown. The downtown people know we're a city, but North Stamford and Chepin and even some of Glenbrook and Springdale would still like to pretend that we're a town. We're the second or third biggest city in Connecticut at this point, and we have a huge police, fire, roads, huge infrastructure to support, and that drives the taxes up.
Coming into what was your proudest moment in your political career so far?
Proudest moment.
Proudest moment.
That's a hard one. I think probably hiring the new superintendent and watching him accomplish so many of the things during his first couple of years that we hoped he would do. It gave me a real sense of actually impacting what was going on in the city, which is appropriate for the school board. I mean, that's really the only thing a school board can do that affects the direction the schools are in. The Board of Reps is a little harder. I've had a input in and some input into a couple of different ordinances that were passed that have some impact. I worked hard with a co-rep in my last term on an ordinance we passed that gave the Planning and Zoning Board the ability to hire independent consultants and charge the consultants to the developer whose text change was being. So that, you know, gave the city's board a little more independence and clout. But it's a very small thing, and it's not the kind of thing where anyone turns around and says, good job.
But it was necessary. I was on the planning board.
Uh-huh.
So I understand. Now, what was your most regrettable moment?
Actually, my most regrettable moment happened just recently during the state nominating conventions for the Democratic Committee. It wasn't a high publicity moment, but I was a delegate to the committee that nominated our district state representative, who at the time was William Tong, and William decided not to run again. So there were two candidates for the nomination. One of them was Matt Blumenthal, whom I had met with and very much admired and was very supportive of. The other one was a latecomer who I got to know. He's a fellow on the colleague on the Board of Representatives, and I got to know him through, we were both on the fiscal committee, through budget negotiations, and I liked what he had to say about confronting unions, not repeating the same kinds of agreements we've signed with unions, yeah. Being more conscious of how the city's money is spent. He claimed that he was not getting heard by the Democratic Party. No one would give him a fair shot at the nomination. So to make a long story short, I nominated him. It turned out to be a really bad mistake. His presentation on the Board of Reps was much better than his approach as a candidate. He turned out to be a very negative candidate whose main interest was in bashing Matt Blumenthal. Instead of talking about the things he had talked about that I heard, that I thought I would like the Democratic Party to take a little more ownership of the union issue and the taxation issue. And he addressed that. But instead, he just bashed Matt Blumenthal. And so I've spent quite a few months now being really sorry that I gave him any airtime at all.
Was being Jewish a help or a hindrance in your political career?
Well, I feel I need to be completely forthcoming and let you know that I converted to Judaism when I got married. So I don't really think about that anymore. I mean, I consider myself Jewish, but it's why I didn't figure in some of those earlier conversations. I haven't ever felt that it was a hindrance in campaigning or running for office at all. I'm not strictly observant, so I, you know, it hasn't impacted what I do on Shabbat or any of that. But it's certainly not something that I feel I need to hide or promote. Either way, I do feel occasionally on the Board of Reps that it is, I won't say a hindrance, but it's a label. And I've never heard anyone say it. I've never heard anyone single out Jews as a group. But there have been some discussions in the Board of Reps where it's kind of neighborhood against neighborhood, but all of a sudden you know that when they're talking about those people in North Stamford, sometimes they're not just talking about those people in North Stamford. So I wouldn't say it's a hindrance, but it can be, I'll stick with the word label, it can be something that you are before anything else.
What about being a woman?
Not really. I remember when Sandy Goldstein ran for mayor, I was really thrilled and happy that there was a female running. But aside from, I haven't felt it as much of a consideration as either having a job or having children, which is obviously part of being a woman, or maybe not. Maybe it's just a part of being a parent. But in my work life, which has been long, when I was first hired for my first job, it was a consideration. I was actually an affirmative action, you know, we need a woman in here. It was in that first wave of feminism mm-hmm. in the early 70s. But I haven't felt it as much in anything that I've done politically.
Would you want your children to be involved in politics?
I'm laughing because I'd be, at this point in their lives, they're both in their early 30s. I would be surprised if either one of them went in that direction, but I think that I was probably 40 before I did, so who knows. Of course I would. If they felt strongly and had the right motives, I would want them to. My daughter, who is the younger of the two, she's 31, never paid any attention at all that I'm aware of until Trump got elected. And she has suddenly, the Women's March right after Trump was elected, for some reason I was not able to go, or I didn't go. And she went to the one in New York City where she lives, and she said, "Mom, what are you doing? You have to go, you have to do something." And I had to look at her and say, "What exactly is it that you think I've been doing for the last 20 years?" And that was her aha moment, I think. I would, if it's a public service initiative or a public service impulse that makes them want to do that, absolutely, yeah.
What legacy do you think you're leaving behind, having done all the things you've done?
I really, that's so hard to answer. If people remember that I was on any of these boards, I would want them to remember that I was fair and impartial above anything else. I'm not, I don't believe that I'm known as a partisan person. I'm not strictly Democratic. I have been known to vote with the Republicans. But I think that my main contribution anywhere I've been has been that I really am a very good listener, and I'm good at listening to both sides. I'm good at pulling out where the common ground is, not all the time, but that's what I try to do. So if I leave a legacy, it would be one that is I'll go back to the public service reason for doing whatever you're doing, and also the desire to move forward, not stick to a partisan path.
Now, I've asked you a lot of questions. Is there anything that you would like to say?
I think I just said it, actually.
I think you did.
Yeah. Yeah, I did. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.